I want to share with you 10 lessons that I've learned in honor of the ministry, the life, and the sacrifice of Prophet TB Joshua. Now, first of all, I just want to mention that from the get-go, the things that I want to share with you, it doesn't mean that I agree or I know every single thing, and that's not my goal. I know their critics will come out and say, oh, you don't know this, you don't know that, and maybe some things I don't know, but I know people who know more than I do, and the things that I want to share with you are the things that I've seen, that I benefited from in my own walk with Christ and as a minister. Number one is I've learned about the power of testimonies. I have never seen in anybody's ministry the amount of time and resources that was dedicated to testimonies. In services, what I've been there, they're about from 10 sometimes to 15 hours long services. Four, sometimes up to 5 hours were given to testimonies. I'm talking about the testimonies. There were so much testimonies. It's not that they dragged on. Some testimonies they did drag on, but so much focus were on testimonies. It's honestly blew my mind. And ever since then, my pastor, and it became a habit where part of Hungry Gen's service, every service, is we have testimonies. And testimonies give birth to testimonies. I saw the emphasis on testimonies. I saw how they would fly people in to share their testimonies. I've never seen TB Joshua bring a guest speaker from another country, but I've seen people being flown in to share their testimony who got healed. And that was really impactful. And it's something that we do till now at Hungry Gen. The second thing that I've learned is deliverance is essential. I think this was the first ministry where it removed the stigma for deliverance for me. I always saw deliverance as like for witches, warlocks, people who practice, you know, voodoo, white magic, black magic. But for normal people, being delivered, like that was, and honestly, our whole team went through deliverance. Most of our team had violent manifestations. The team that you see now who are praying for other people, they were delivered. Most of them were delivered right there in Skowen. And they really normalize deliverance. And I think it's one of the things that even God is using our ministry today is to normalize deliverance among Christians. You know, God wants to normalize what Jesus did on the earth. And the devil wants us to normalize pain and suffering. And it's time to neutralize what many churches have normalized, which is demonization, oppression, depression, etc. And in the ministry of TB Joshua, I saw that deliverances were normal, a lot of deliverances. And, you know, today we see that more in our ministry. Number three, I learned about the importance of prayer line preparation. Now, they call it prayer line screening or prayer line pre-counseling, different verbiage, but the amount of preparation that's given to prayer line before prayer line is crazy, honestly. The first time we went there, we were blown away. They wanted to see our medical reports. They wanted to make sure they were properly signed. They wanted to record videos before we got prayed for. They were consulting with us. They were asking for confession of sin. I mean, I was like, what? Do we do that stuff? And so I just kind of thought, you know, how I saw it in America. You just kind of come to the meeting and then just whatever happens. But they were very intentional about people who are coming to prayer. And so they were consulting them, praying with them. And it's one of the things we do at Hungry Gen is that we implement. I've never seen this in anybody else's ministry where public deliverance is done, but there is a personal private preparation that's done for hours before that. In the Skowen, they do preparation a day before that, sometimes 2 days before that, and they don't pray for anybody in the prayer line who does not go through that preparation. And that's why they see a greater result, because people are prepared properly. And that's one of the reasons we see results is because of preparation. And honestly, we learned that from his ministry. Number four, I've learned about the importance of prayer confrontation in the service. One of the reasons why demonic manifestations happen and deliverances in the services is because of prayer confrontation, meaning confrontational prayer, where you do a mass prayer and you have people repeat after you. And this prayer is not just, you know, a Heavenly Father, but this prayer is a warfare prayer where you go address the spiritual entities. You know, we see that in the scriptures where Jesus addressed demons. He told us to speak to the mountain. You know, he spoke to the sickness. He spoke to the fig tree. He spoke to these things that, you know, he spoke to spiritual entities. He spoke to the waves and told them to shut up. And so, and I've seen that in the ministry where, you know, TB Joshua would come out and do a mass prayer with the wise men at the time. It was electric, the atmosphere. The demons would come out of everywhere. It's like stuff was just coming out. It was crazy. And, you know, it's one of the things that we practice that now, maybe not in every service, but we practice in a confrontational warfare prayer, massive prayer. And one of the things that we saw in him is not just one person walking around, but we have different people that help us pray. So it's not just one, me, but we have a pastoral team. So we rotate. One person takes one prayer point, the other person takes another prayer point. And that really, the lesson we've learned from the ministry of Prophet TB Joshua. Number five, what I've learned is the importance of media. One of the things that the Lord spoke to TB Joshua from the beginning is to get a camera and start recording when he only had few people. And it really impacted me when we saw there how much emphasis is placed on recording, archiving, storing, getting the proper footage, because the media is the tool that gets the word of God out today. And so through the Emmanuel, it's no accident that, you know, TB Joshua had 1,600,000 subscribers on his YouTube. You know, it got suspended a month ago because of his video on deliverance from lesbianism or homosexuality, one of those videos. But it's no accident that his ministry is one of the most known ministries around the world. He's not, his church, like the local church that it's at, it's not the biggest church. It's not actually very big. It's big, but it's not very big. But the influence is great because he was intentional about media. And you know, if you notice one thing about Hungry Gen, and he's not the only one, but definitely played an effect. Earlier days of deliverance, earlier days of our intentional focus on the website, on blogs, on YouTube, and on all of that stuff. And so I think media is very important, and it's one of the things that I learned from him as well. Number six, something that touched me very powerfully is how prophecy deals with the root of the problem. It's not just pat on the back. Now, I understand there's a personal prophecy. There's a prophecy where every believer can prophesy. It's to encourage, build up, and exhort. There's the office of the prophet. And even the prophets in the United States, the people that I've seen, they're slightly different than what I've seen in the ministry of TB Joshua. I grew up in the Russian culture, Slavic culture, where prophetic voices were slightly different. It was more condemning, more of doom and gloom, which still has its place. I believe it still has its place, especially for an office of a prophet. But one thing that shocked me is the amount of prophecies I've seen in TB Joshua where they are honestly under 1 minute. Some prophecies were very short, but they were very deep in the sense it took weeks for stories to begin to come out. Like, for example, one time he says, you know, I see two boys, and he says they were kidnapped. Come out. He tells somebody to come out. He points it to that particular sanctuary. A lady comes out, lifts a picture. She says, my boys were kidnapped. The ransom has never been placed. And in those places, if a ransom is not demanded, that means the boys were kidnapped either for some kind of a slavery or for organs or, you know, to be killed. And so and TB Joshua begins to share. He's like, I see a vision. I see those boys and I see God causing confusion. And they will be released on Tuesday. And then Tuesday you get a phone call. You pick them up. And next Sunday you'll be here. Just walks away and keeps talking about other stuff. Literally, very short prophecy. Next Sunday the mama comes with two boys and they testify exactly that's how it happened. You know, like, I mean, prophecies where he would come in and say, you know, I see a daughter. And the guy and his wife says, no, we don't have children. That's why we're here. We want to have children. He says, I see a daughter. He says, no, I don't have a children. Sir, I don't have children. He says, I see a daughter. And he says, you made a girl pregnant in school and you denied the pregnancy. And because of that, you cannot have children. And until you go find that child and take care of that child, God cannot give you children from your wife. You know, very short, but it was so powerful. It was the key that unlocked the person's life. And so that was honestly very impactful. And I pray that God will begin to raise more prophets like that, who don't just pat on the back, who don't just, you know, share encouragement, you know, and just lovey-dovey. That has its place, to build and courage. But prophecies that go into the root of the problem, expose the root of the problem, and bring solution. Number seven, what I've learned is the simplicity of teaching and preaching. TB Joshua's sermons are very short in comparison to the ministry time that's taken. They're very simple. Child can understand them. They're not super complicated, and yet they're very powerful. And so it really showed me that, you know, the sermons of Jesus were kind of similar. Like, they were not necessarily, you know, 27 points, and they had this very clever twist of words that caused people to go, wow, that's deep, man, that's great. They were very simple teachings, but it's the power that was behind it that was powerful, that this is teaching. Be different than the teaching of the Pharisees and the Sadducees and all other people, because he preached with authority. Number eight, one of the things that impacted me personally is the radical generosity of TB Joshua. The first trip we took there, we had about 11 people that went with us, 11 or 12 people. He refunded each one of our tickets. Yes. and then gave each one of us about $300 to help us with our expenses. Now, that totally blew us off because we came with clothes to bless Africa. He told us to take those clothes back and to take it because America is in greater need now than Africa. Like, that totally was a shock. When we arrived back home, I received a phone call from TB Joshua, and he says, I'm going to wire, I think it was $15,000. It was during Christmas time. And he says, I want you to find less fortunate people, and I want you to buy them gifts and buy them things that they need. And I want you to record everything so that, you know, I could see that you guys didn't spend money on new rims or on your own vacation, which was like, yeah, of course. It was honestly very shocking. Even ABC News picked up a story in Spokane where we bought different things for rehab centers, and it was from Africa. I know, this was crazy, huh? And people are like, what? This is, we usually, you know, donate money there, and this time money's coming here. When we had a conference here with Wiseman Harry, this might shock you, okay? And a lot of people don't know about this, and that's why I'm exposing all of this, because some of you don't know, you know, you hear critics or you hear this and that, but I want you to hear about this. When we had the conference, they flew about, TB Joshua flew about 20 people from Africa. The tickets are extremely expensive if you ever flew to Africa, okay? These people were here for at least 2 weeks, okay? Our church did not have enough money to rent the facility for the conference. So we were actually willing to take a loan and start using our own personal credit cards just to get that building. Now, we did not tell TB Joshua we couldn't afford it. So he paid for the building. He paid for everybody's flights. And he did not allow us to take an offering first 2 days. He did not allow anything to be sold. And on the third day when we picked up an offering, he said, make sure the offering is picked up after 7 hours service, and that that offering went to Hungry Gen. And on the top of that, they brought a gift, a very generous gift, cash gift, to Hungry Gen to bless our ministry. They did not get anything from us. They did not want anything from us. Honestly, I've never seen that from anybody. Okay, you can say whatever you want to say about TB Joshua, but that to me was a huge deal. Twice our team went to help Prophet TB Joshua, one time in Mexico, one time in Colombia. Okay, sometimes, one time we had 30 people that went. Everyone's ticket was paid for by him. We were willing to go on our own expense. He covered everybody's flight, he covered everybody's food, and then gave everybody a short little cash gift just to honor them. Okay, and that, I seen that up close. That's not, you know, he didn't do that so he can be praised, because nobody knows about this stuff. Another time, I remember I was going from Nigeria to Tanzania to preach with my friend Roman Trachuk. He invited me to help him, and Roman covered my ticket to Tanzania. I went to TB Joshua's church, and somebody spilled the beans and told him that I'm going to Tanzania to do a service. And so he tells me, are you going to Tanzania? I said, yes, sir, I'm going to Tanzania. He says, I want to connect you to one of my VIP partners there so that she can support you financially. And I said, no, sir, I don't need the finances. And then he gives me, I think it was $6,000 or $5,000, which I was like, sir, I have my ticket paid for. He says, I know. He says, but I just want to bless your ministry. And that really, honestly, first of all, you know, I didn't need that money, so we gave that money away to other ministries and to other causes. But it really, that's what I saw up close. And it made me want to be that person. So a lot of stuff that you see on TV, you know, giving to the homeless and giving to the poor, I'm going to tell you one thing about that man. He lived like that behind closed doors. And I was a recipient of that. It's one of the things that marked my life, that we started to give. It's not the only reason, but one of the reasons we started to give generously, our savings, our cars. I think we up to 6 cars now that we've given away, me and my wife, because we were impacted by the extravagant generosity that has to go along with the life of supernatural. Now, number 9, that I learned, how the anointing is transferable. Anointing water was a very controversial topic for many people, especially in the Western circles where we're used to anointing oil, handkerchiefs of Paul, and that's it. And the water, I remember so much hate that we got, so much criticism. Man, people couldn't fight, of course, the results, but they fought the anointing water. And honestly, water, it was just the water. There was nothing different about it. But the concept is in the Bible where anointing is transferable. Anointing works through objects. The rod of Moses, saliva of Jesus, the river of Jordan. You know, when anointing comes in contact with an object, it carries God's power. It's not charms. We're not talking about charms, but honestly, that's how the principle of charms work. is the evil power goes through objects, and people who bring those objects come under influence of that evil power. You know, people talk about stories where they take handkerchiefs and they take belts of Paul, and even though that's not a rule, but it's a principle that the anointing of God operates through hands, through the vocal cords, through handkerchiefs, through different objects, and it worked through anointing water. I've seen it firsthand. I've seen incurable sicknesses were healed when we prayed with anointing water through the name of Jesus. Now, there was no power in that water, but the power was through the water from the Holy Spirit, and I've seen it firsthand. Number 10, what I've learned is the importance of not reacting toward critics. T.B. Joshua, I think, had more critics than I could, that anybody I can know. Honestly, the amount of criticism that he had in Africa, the amount of criticism, and I knew most of the criticism because I read about it. I read, followed the websites. There's websites that are dedicated. There is his ex-disciples and all of this stuff, and how focused he was on doing what he's supposed to do. Even when the prophecy about Hillary and Donald Trump, you know, surfaced, when the building collapsed, and I mean, there was so much stuff, that different tribulations that followed his ministry, different accusations that followed his ministry, and it didn't stop him. He just kept on going. And you know, I know that in the ministry you can't avoid criticism. If you're creating something, if you are a movement, you will draw criticism. There's just no way it's possible. Unless you're a monument, you're stuck, you're going nowhere, then of course nobody's going to talk about you. And from the beginning of our ministry, we learned to honestly deal with that as well by not giving critics attention and just focusing on our calling, focusing on what the Lord...